And the next thing I want to talk about in terms of music is Fred again. Fred again. I was listening to him have an interview with Zane Lowe, and I enjoyed the interview. I thought he came across really well, but there's a part of me that just couldn't buy it. I couldn't buy into him as a person. I don't know what it is. He just seems too nice. He just seems too personable. He just seems like somebody you want to root for and want to see win. But it's just a part of me, the cynical side of me, that's sitting there thinking, nah, there's something off about this guy. And then I remembered Fred again was the same guy that I covered in that other story in my podcast about this DJ. I think her name is Bambi or Bammy. I forgot it. One or the other. Bambi or Bammy. One of them who was DJing somewhere on the same bill as Fred again and the Blessed Madonna, formerly known as the Black Madonna. And she got there on time to do a set, and essentially both of those artists basically prevented her from playing because they were too in the zone and didn't want to let her play because they were feeling the vibe and they just wanted to continue on. And I thought it was really horrendous, because I think as an up-and-coming DJ myself, I've been in that position before where you're basically supporting a really big artist. You're either opening or closing, and they either try and eat into your opening time because they want to get on, or they don't ever come off at the end because they're really in a mood now, or they're high or they're drunk, whatever it may be. So you don't have a chance to play yourself. So you basically waste your whole day there just waiting for them to finish and to kind of get off the decks. And usually if they're the higher caliber person, no one in management wants to tell them anything because they're the star. So you're there waiting, you know, holding your flipping nuts in your hand. And by the time you get on to play, you've got 20 minutes left. And I think the same thing might have happened to this girl that I'm talking about. I think she might play for longer, maybe it's 45 minutes. But the really egregious part of it is, they didn't apologize. None of them did, not publicly anyway. And this is also a little bit, I think it might have happened a little bit before that thing happened with Carnage, who's changed his name, innit? What's his name now? Is it, it's still Carnage anyway. We know that DJ, right? Who's associated with Drake and had some credits on his House album. And he obviously got involved in that passer, which I covered on my podcast, where he essentially did the same thing, but he did it with Chest. These guys, Fred again and Bless Madonna, I'm pretty sure they kind of said no to coming off through their agents. And I think just like by ignoring, they didn't really say, I'm not coming off. I think the other guy, Carnage or Cardo, I think his name is, he basically said it with Chest. No, I'm not coming off. I'm playing until the end. And, you know, the internet kind of cancelled him, were going after him, getting these comments, harassing him. And he essentially did a good thing. You know, he kind of made it about him and the apology, but he made it right. He basically said, I'm sorry. He admitted his fault. He basically explained it, which I thought was hilarious, him explaining why he fucked them over. And then in the end, he basically said, hey, if you want to come and see another show of mine, VIP tickets or whatever it may be, or something, play on my set. I forgot what it is, but he basically apologized and acknowledged it publicly. And I don't think Fred again or Bless Madonna ever acknowledged it. So for some reason, I think that might be tainting how I look at this kid and how I kind of view his art. Because, you know, when you do things like that, for me, it's sort of similar to, like, you know, this story recently we had about James Corden going to that restaurant Baltazar in New York, and him and his wife basically kicking up a fuss and being really horrendous patrons and, you know, complaining about stuff and, you know, throwing a fit over stuff that could easily be fixed. I think one of the issues was something about the egg whites running into the, or the yolk running into the flipping egg whites or something, something about a hair, and like crazy stuff, right? And it just came across like really entitled, arrogant cunts, and it kind of tells you everything about them as people. So when I hear these stories about, you know, Bless Madonna and Fred again, it kind of makes me think behind that kind of nice, you know, I'm just a nice guy from north of England or wherever he's fucking from, just trying to make music and, you know, remember the memory of my friends and all this sort of cute stuff, that behind it there's like a bit of sinister evilness going on there that would make you want to, you know, not let somebody play who's booked on the same bill as you. Especially if you're an up-and-coming person, you know what the fucking hustle's like. You know how hard it is to get on that stage. You know how hard it is to build up your career, to get to a point where you're at, where you're at, where you're headlining stuff. So you know the grind. You've been to hotel lobbies and seen a DJ play in a lounge, and, you know, for flipping 10 people who don't care. You know what the grind is like. So you should be, you know, understanding. But I guess some people, when they get to a certain level, they don't understand anything. So that's the thing that left a bit of a sour taste in my mouth. But anyway, moving on, I obviously saw what we all saw. I saw the boiler room. We all saw the boiler room, right? And I think, yeah, we definitely all saw it, bruv. It's fucking, it's at 7.9 million views. And then first of all, when I saw it, I wasn't aware that this guy did fucking, you know, live performance when he did his fucking DJing or his performing. I thought it was just a basic CDJ guy. But then I remembered, oh shit, this is the same guy that produced that EP with Heady One that I absolutely hated. So it kind of gave me another reason why I'm probably a little bit cynical on a dude, because that Heady One EP, when that came out, I was like, oh my God, no, they're going to try and turn Heady One into fucking Pitbull or something and give him these horrible fucking electronic music flipping records that are only going to be played in fucking Miami, and it sounds horrendous. But having watched this guy perform live on Boiler Room, you know, in front of a crowd that clearly gets and connects with what he does, it kind of made me think, okay, this guy's a little bit sick, and he's a bit special. Let's not lie, the guy is flipping special. And I think we all know the track that stands out in that set was definitely this Fred Again, Swedish House Mafia, Turn on the Lights, Future record, right? Which for me is kind of justifies why I always kind of thought, like, why aren't there more dance music, especially when it comes to like techno and EDM and maybe even, you know, just regular dance records that sample more hip-hop tracks, especially vocals, because I think there are so many cool vocals nowadays that people could sample that would sound amazing. Just even strip away anything on the actual song itself, or just take the sample itself, because a lot of these guys, I always spoke about Lancey Foe and his melodies and the way they use their voices as instruments. There's already an instrumentation value on, or kind of tone on their voice by how they harmonize and their croning as their ad libs. So you can essentially use that voice or the vocal itself on the record, and it could kind of go where you want it to go, but it could also form the structure of your flipping song and how it kind of fits in terms of the beats and shit. And obviously that Swedish House Mafia track with Flipping Future and stuff, it just sounds amazing, right? Turn off the lights, I'm looking for her. And you, no verse, you just get that fucking, that, what was it, that hook or that chorus bit, like, blows your mind. And obviously it's fucking amazing, but it also made me think immediately about this track that I remember hearing randomly on this set from 2019 at Untold. And if I'm not mistaken, this set features Jamie Jones and Martinez Brothers, and Seth Trucks are playing back to back. If I'm not mistaken, this was meant to be live streamed, but something happened with the equipment, so they only was able to live stream half an hour worth of it. But this was a really good set. And of course, these guys are kind of really commercial. They probably occupy the business techno side of things. But I remember hearing this track that samples 21 Savage's X Bitch, which features also Future on it also. And it sounds incredible. I think Seth Structure is the one mixing it in. So I'm going to play it now. Hopefully it doesn't get flagged. If it does get flagged, it doesn't matter. But I think this track is amazing, and also goes to show that, you know, that as good as that Fred Again track is, I think there's evidence that this stuff clearly works. So if you're a producer out there, please take vocals from hip hop tracks and make them into fucking booming tech house tracks, tools, techno tools, EBM tools, electro tools, whatever it may be, because, you know, we need them on the dance floor.
I love that hoe alone cause she was wrecked. All these bitches start to
Hold up. Jax, bitch. Hold up. So amazing. For me, an amazing record. And it kind of reminded me, I was reminded of it when I obviously heard that absolutely booming track with Fred Again, Swedish House Mafia, featuring flipping Future, Turn Out the Lights. But on the actual album itself, man, I know, like I said before, that whole issue with the DJ thing made me have a sour taste in my mouth about this kid. The whole thing with the Heady One album or that EP was horrendous. I threw that straight in the bin. But this, Actual Life 3, and I'm even not even a fan of this whole, like, the whole voice notes thing and the clips and stuff and, you know, the forced emotion and whatnot in it, but you can't help but feel something. That's an annoying thing. It feels calculated. It feels intentional. It feels almost manipulative, right? The thing, the voice, the fucking emotion, the voice notes of it, the fact that he fucking names the tracks after the people that are fucking, you know, helping to do it and stuff. And it's all a personal connection. And he's featuring people on here who legitimately have like under 5,000 followers. And he's putting them on his fucking album because he just loves what they do. And you're discovering all these new people through this one guy. It's incredible that way. But you kind of feel like you're being manipulated, but you don't care because the music's so good. Like, one of the standout tracks I said about 5,000 followers, one is this track here called Winnie, End of Me, like track 12. Like, incredible, legitimately incredible. The kind of track you, if you used to hear that performed live, you legitimately might cry, especially if you're on the right sort of drugs, honestly. And then there's a track here that I like, one of my favorites, track 4, Cammy, Like I Do. Incredible, booming, almost funky house type feeling track, like just a complete vibe. Like, that will definitely get you to fucking, you're definitely going to get sturdy listening to that sort of shit. So I don't know, man, I'm still a little bit on the fence about the kid, but I think he's special. I legitimately think this kid has got it. Like, legitimately, he's special on a level where, like, if he just keeps doing what he's doing, he might change things forever in dance music. But I just, you know what I mean? I'm finding it hard to kind of fully get into it and like it because everyone else likes it. And it's so fucking bait and commercial. But the guy is really good. Like, he's incredibly supremely talented artist, talented producer. There's bits in it where it's allegedly it's his voice singing. I'm not sure if that's true. When I looked at the credits and said it, I'm like, oh my God, can he actually sing as well? He's just an absolute beast. So I can't wait to see what he does going forward in his career. But Actual Life 3, bravo. Again, I'm not that well clued in with his discography. Like I said, I was kind of, you know, I kind of went sour off him based on what I said earlier on, but this is going to make me go back into the flipping archive. It's also going to make me want to maybe go to a live show. I know the tickets are sold out, but I'm definitely be able to get one again. You know, you can always get some again on the resale sites, like ticket swaps and stuff, on the day. But I might have to see what he does live and see him again and see his full power to see what I got on, because this kid is a bit special, mate. Actual Life 3 is absolutely incredible. So check it out if you haven't already. Actual Life 3 by Fred Again. Give him a chance.